I'm Anne Marie Slaughter. I'm the president and CEO of New America, and I may never have been prouder to say that than today. So we are quite literally trying to welcome you to a new America. For the next day and a half, we want you to imagine that we are a country that can fix our problems, meet our challenges, and renew ourselves, as we have done often in our history. And indeed, we've been in places that were just as difficult and seemingly broken as we are today. What we are offering are 10 big ideas for a new America. We are going to be talking about education and economic policy and manufacturing and foreign policy and leisure, a subject of great interest at New America. We are looking at warfare, the Americas. We have a set of ideas really across the board. All of those ideas are by design too big to be rolled into a policy proposal. They are umbrella ideas. They all integrate technology. One of the things New America is most committed to is the idea that going forward, in some cases, code is policy. And in every case, code is a key part of policy, but code alone won't do it. So in Washington, I spend a lot of time talking about technology. In Silicon Valley, I spend a lot of time talking about policy, process, politics, all the stuff that has to go hand in hand with technology. And all of these ideas are designed to reach way beyond the Beltway, to reach to a next generation of politics, of coalitions that are really drawn together by the substance of the ideas. So big ideas, bridging technology, beyond the Beltway, we really invite you to imagine with us. Punctuating those panels on ideas will be our keynote speakers. And I'm going to introduce our lead-off keynote speaker, Senator John McCain, in just a minute. But before I do that, let me just do a couple of thank yous and shout-outs. So first of all, I have to thank the law firm of McDermott, Will, and Emery for this fabulous space. New America's been looking for new space. I think I've just found it. So we are really delighted that you are hosting us. And I want to thank our media partner, CNN. They are live streaming our keynotes, and they're lending us a lot of their talent. We will hear Candy Crowley interview Van Jones, and that will actually be on the Sunday show. And for featuring op-eds on CNN.com, they will also be rolling out longer versions of these 10 big ideas over the next 6 months. For all of you, we are live streaming this. That means some of you, certainly all of you up here and even in the audience, this is being captured for immortality, at least until our tech team manages to figure out how that won't be for forever and protects our privacy a little better. But for now, it is going to be live streamed, so be aware of that. There are cameras in the room all day. And also, for those of you who are tweeters, please do tweet away. Our hashtag is 10 Big Ideas. So with that, it is really my pleasure to introduce Senator John McCain. And I'm going to do it in a way probably even he doesn't expect. That's a good thing. So I wrote a book called The Idea That Is America, and it was published in 2007. I was on the board of New America at that time. But what inspired the title was the following, and it's a letter, and it says, "Do we sacrifice our ideals to preserve security? Terrorism inspires fear and suppresses ideals like freedom and individual rights. Overcoming the fear posed by terrorist threats is a tremendous test of our courage. Will we confront danger and adversity in order to preserve our ideals, or will our courage and commitment to individual rights wither at the prospect of sacrifice?" My response is simple. If we abandon our ideals in the face of adversity and aggression, then those ideals were never really in our possession. I would rather die fighting than give up even the smallest part of the idea that is America. That letter was not written by John McCain, but it could have been, but it was written to him. and it was written by Captain Ian Fishback, who was a captain in Iraq who was trying to publicize the abuses at Abu Ghraib. And he knew that if he wrote to John McCain, he had tried to go through the hierarchy, he had gotten nowhere. He knew that if he wrote to Senator McCain, he would be heard. And he was heard, and Senator McCain fought the good fight on Abu Ghraib, on torture, on Guantanamo, on standing up for the ideals that are at the heart of the idea that is America and of a new America. I can't imagine anyone better suited to open our conference. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Anne Marie, for that kind words and kind introduction. And I'm not sure that I can take credit for a lot of things that I've done, although I'd love to. But the issue of torture, I thought, was a fundamental about what America is all about. And I appreciate you mentioning it, because I still view it as one of the more shameful chapters in our history. And I'm glad that we were able to, through our efforts in the Senate, pass into law a prohibition for the use of torture and observance of the Geneva Conventions, of which the United States is a signatory. And I thank you for not mentioning that I ran for president. I appreciate that. After I lost, I slept like a baby. Sleep 2 hours, wake up and cry. Sleep 2 hours. Since we're here at the law firm, I would like to thank them for their hosting this. And naturally, I have to tell my favorite lawyer joke, which is, do you know the difference between a lawyer and a catfish? One is a scum-sucking bottom dweller, and the other is a fish. I thought I'd throw that in there. I don't think I'll be invited back. Anyway, I also want to thank Anne Marie for not only all of the advocacy she has done for freedom and democracy and human rights throughout the world, but also especially on the issue of Syria, which maybe we can discuss a little more. And I appreciate her and the New America Foundation for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this important conference. You've asked me to speak to your theme today, Big Ideas for a New America. And I'm grateful that you think a member of Congress has any ideas, let alone big ideas. In case you missed it, the approval rating of Congress is 12%. I've not met anyone in that category yet. In fact, we're down to paid staff and blood relatives. I tell that fairly often, but I'm not making this up. My mother is 102 years old. I received a call from her the other day, and she now, we're down to paid staff. So, anyway, what I suggest is not new. It's actually an old idea, but it's one that I fear that our nation is losing sight of, and that is the indispensability of American power, influence, and leadership in the world. All of us believe that ideas can change the world. That's the whole reason why we are here today. And the idea is that America at its best has championed indeed what Anne Marie once called the idea that is America. Have done more to make the world a better place than at any time in history. It's because of our ideas that it has become customary for overwhelming majorities of people and governments around the world to believe that the legitimacy of government derives from the consent of the governed, that the rule of law is the beginning of justice, that free markets and free trade are the basis of all successful economies, that state sovereignty is not a license to commit mass atrocities and genocide, that all human beings have equal rights that should be respected, that torture should always be forbidden, and that wars of conquest and aggression should be relegated to the bloody past. These ideas are not America's alone. We don't own them. But these ideas have not advanced on their own or implemented themselves. More than any other factor or force or nation, America has done that. Yes, we've had help. We've had partners and allies of immeasurable value, and we still do. But ultimately, our ideas, our values, our vision of a better world, the norms, laws, and institutions we have established to sustain these ideas and the conditions of peace and security from the Americas to Europe to Asia, in which these ideas have been able to flourish and spread, all of this progress has been underwritten by one thing most of all, us, American power, influence, and leadership. Our capacity, diplomatic, economic, and yes, military, to make our ideas reality and to provide the most reliable and effective check against the forces that would do harm to our vision of world order. That is the role that America has played and still must play. Unfortunately, we are not. In recent years, more and more Americans have come to believe that we should mind our own business and let the world sort itself out. Many have assumed that America could pull back and somehow the void would be filled by the growing progress of the 21st century. Not by its violent fanatics and aggressive dictators, its torturers and human traffickers and deniers of human dignity, its brutish rulers who believe might makes right, and all the other forces of tragedy of which history is so replete. Too many Americans seem to have forgotten that while the tides of war may recede, what holds them at bay most over time is our power and influence. It is troubling enough to see this denial of reality among so many Americans and members of Congress of both parties, including, I'm sad to say, among some Republicans. But to see it from the administration is not merely unfortunate. It is dangerous. At a time when the global demand for American leadership and influence has never been higher, our president seems committed to supplying as little of them as possible, and we see the consequences of this all around the world. We see it in Syria, where nearly 150,000 people have been killed. One-third of the population has been driven from their homes. Radicalization and sectarian conflict are spreading throughout the entire region, and there is no end in sight. We see it in the terrorist safe havens in places like Syria, Libya, and Iraq, where the sworn enemies of America and our friends are once again gathering by the thousands and planning to do us harm, and they're nearly uncontested in doing so. We see it in the heart of Europe, where Russia has invaded Ukraine and redrawn internationally recognized borders by force, all for the sole purpose of acquiring another country's sovereign territory and resurrecting its old imperial ambitions. We see it in Asia, where China is using its growing power and military capabilities to assert territorial claims without basis in international law, change the status quo unilaterally, and harass U.S. allies and partners in the South and East China Seas. And we see it in America's allies, from Europe to the Middle East to Asia, who are now questioning whether they can rely on America, as they have for decades, to meet our commitments to our mutual security if our red lines are crossed. American power and influence are still the currency of the international order. But at present, we are at growing risk of the geopolitical equivalent of a bank run. People and governments, friends and adversaries alike, are coming to see America as weak, unreliable, and lacking credibility. And they are starting to suspect that America may longer have the will, the capacity, or both to meet its obligations as the underwriter of the world order. Many are panicking. Others are celebrating. Some say that we cannot afford to take a different course. I believe we can't afford not to, and the choice is up to us. The greatest limitations on America's role in the world today and in the future are not those of capacity, but rather of our resolve and imagination. We have a growing population, the world's most dynamic economy, new sources of energy that are the envy of the world, the most proven and effective military on the planet, and a risk-taking society with a nearly infinite ability to revitalize itself. So this is not a question of capacity, nor is it a question of options. The president would have us believe that the only alternative to our current course is a series of land invasions and wars without end. Literally no one is arguing for that, and it is a height of intellectual dishonesty to suggest so. It's also a disservice to our citizens, for whether it is in Ukraine or Syria or the seas of Asia or elsewhere, there is a range of options at our disposal that can put greater force behind our diplomacy, restore the confidence of shaken allies, reestablish deterrence over our adversaries, and make our ideas reality. This will require us to do more and bear more burdens and accept more risk in the short term. And it will certainly require an honest conversation with the American people about what is at stake. But let no one suggest that we are without options. Let's be clear. The question we face is not whether America can maintain its preeminence and the world it sustains, but whether we will choose to do so. I believe we must, most importantly because it is in our national interest. No one benefits more from America's ideas of world order than Americans themselves. They make us more secure and more prosperous. But our ideas also benefit others. It is no coincidence that the greatest expansion of peace, freedom, and prosperity in human history has occurred during the period of America's global preeminence. And we must never forget that if America chooses not to play this role, if we allow ourselves to believe that we cannot do it anymore, or that we have no good options, as if we ever do, our best ideas and highest hopes will be left defenseless, our world will drift further into chaos and tragedy, and the costs of this calamity will ultimately be borne not just by foreign peoples, but by Americans. Our people are never eager to engage in foreign policy, and that is the healthy attitude of democratic citizens. But there are events and threats in the world that demand our attention and from which we cannot isolate ourselves. And it is in these times that the American people rely on our elected leaders, most of all our president, to lead them, to explain to them where our interests and values are at greatest risk, why we cannot afford to be disengaged, why delay will only allow present dangers to grow into more dire future threats, and what we must do. That is what America's greatest leaders have done. They have rallied the nation to play the role in the world that only America can. That's what we need now more than ever. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator McCain. The floor is open for questions.
Or comments or insults.
Yes, Ted Halstead, our founding president.
Senator McCain, thank you very much for joining us today. You know, there's been a tremendous amount of attention to Russia's newfound assertiveness in Ukraine and so forth, but one feature of this that has gotten a lot less attention is our own hemisphere. And there are indications now that Russia plans to partner with China in building a Nicaragua canal, an alternative to the Panama Canal, which has been a bedrock of our Monroe Doctrine, if you will, for a long time. Russia apparently has agreements with Nicaragua to start building military bases, naval patrols, surveillance technology, all in Nicaragua. Secretary Kerry recently said that the Monroe Doctrine is essentially finished and over. So what does this mean exactly? What should America's response be if, in fact, the Chinese and the Russians start building an alternative canal, if Russia starts building a major military presence just south of our border? What are your thoughts, please?
First of all, my thoughts, probably my highest priority right now is Venezuela. There is brutal repression there. The economy of a very oil-rich country is in the tank. Mr. Maduro, the successor to Mr. Chavez, who joined Karl Marx and Joseph Stalin somewhere, is brutally repressive, and also, I believe they have some ambitions to have that spread throughout the region, and closer and closer ties with Cuba. I think what Vladimir Putin is doing, as far as the visit of a Russian ship to Havana and this rumors of different activities, is mainly meant to sort of appease his chauvinistic kind of ambitions. Frankly, the Panama Canal has just been expanded in the most dramatic way, which is going to change, frankly, a lot of our economy because of the different ports that they're now, major large ships are going to be able to transport goods to. So I really don't see how another canal through Nicaragua would be really fundamentally economically viable. So I think that it's more a little bit of saber rattling on Putin's part of his ego that needs to be constantly fed. By the way, in case you didn't know, I'm probably the only American you'll talk to that was censored by the Arizona Republican Party and sanctioned by Vladimir Putin. Now that's a rare combination. You gotta admit. So I worry a little bit more about China, not from a belligerent way, but when you see what China is doing throughout the world, particularly Asian parts of Africa, you'll see that they are spending a lot of money, and they're building roads, and they're doing things for these countries, and they are increasing their influence rather dynamically and significantly. And they have the money to do it, and Russia doesn't. So long term, I would be a bit concerned about the broadening and deepening influence of China, which isn't, you know, it doesn't mean they're going to start a war with us. But I think it's pretty clear the Chinese don't share our values and our ideals.
Thank you.
Kati.
Senator, thank you for speaking to us. And I find it
difficult to disagree with most of what you said. But of course, the question is implementation and execution. At this stage in the game, what would you, if I know you don't want to talk about your run for that. But if you were president, what would you be doing in Syria? Not 2 years ago, but now.
Thank you for that question. You know, we talk about things that keep us awake at night. Nothing really keeps me awake at night, but I can assure you that sometimes I wake up and think about my visits to the refugee camps in Jordan and Lebanon. It's most gripping experience, particularly the children, everywhere children. The teacher was taking me around the refugee camp. She said, "See all these children, Senator McCain?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "You know, they believe that the United States has abandoned them, and they're going to take revenge on the United States for us failing to help them." You know, we may be raising a generation of jihadists in these refugee camps that are now holding. Look, Lebanon has 1 million refugees. What do you think it would be like to have 1 million refugees in the United States of America, which is 50 times larger? So what I wanted to do from the beginning was give assistance to the resistance. And there was a seminal moment after about 2 years ago when Iran convinced Hezbollah to come into Syria. 5,000 seasoned, well-trained, not afraid to die fighters, plus dramatic increase in arms shipments from Russia and from Syria, and Iranian Revolutionary Guard people really orchestrating the tactical on-the-ground conflict. That was a seminal sea change in what was going on in Syria. At that time, and I understand your question, but at that time, weapons supplies would have probably done it. Now we are giving more weapons, my friends. I read in published reports that we are giving them some anti-armor capability, and we're giving them some more capabilities. And again, I read, I'm not briefed by And I'm quite often I don't want to be brief because I don't want to say anything that is classified, but there's a great debate on whether to use give them anti-air capabilities. Well, I think that if we'd have done that a year ago, that might have shifted the equation. But as Bashar Assad has progressively consolidated power and continued to succeed, I believe that we would have to establish a humanitarian zone that we would protect, where we could help refugees, where we could help the Free Syrian Army, where we could help our Free Syrian Army now and the Syrian National Council. Our guys, they're fighting on two fronts. They're fighting Bashar Assad, and they're fighting al-Nusra and ISIS, radical Islamist organizations. And so it's almost a self-fulfilling promise that, well, we may be ended up with the two evils. Well, we may, if it continues in this fashion. But that's because we're not helping these people defend themselves. So that's what I would do, and I would give them anti-air. You know, the most atrocious thing is going on right now, my friends. It's called barrel bombs. You know what they are? They're massive cylinders filled with scrap metal that by helicopter, the Bashar Assad is dropping on populated areas of Syria. Atrocious weapon with impunity. And you know, it doesn't discriminate who it kills. And we sit by and watch this? Well, all I can say is a humanitarian zone, anti-air capability, and also weapons that they can use effectively.
Thank you. I'll just add, I won't add, I would second everything you said, but I will just add that the equivalent of refugees is the equivalent in terms of percentage of the population of Lebanon and Jordan. It is the equivalent as if all of Canada moved to the United States. It's one-third, a tenth of the population. So just for comparison.
And so refugees disrupt economies. It isn't just you've got refugee camps. You've got drives labor costs down or drives real estate prices up. It does has all kinds of destabilizing effects on a country. And we all know that Lebanon has a history of not really a very unstable situation because of religious differences.
So the questions are all coming from our left. I'm looking at them right there.
There's a microphone right there.
Howard LaFranchi with the Christian Science Monitor. Recently, I did a piece on what some are calling new isolationism in the United States, which you spoke about. And one thing I was surprised to find was that actually this sentiment is strongest among young people, among young Americans. And very often, and I went out and spoke to some, and very often they say, look, we failed in Iraq, we were failing, we failed in Afghanistan, so it's not an answer anyway, so we might as well just mind our own business, as you said. So how do you respond to that sentiment that, well, we've failed when we've become involved? What would you say, especially to the young people?
Thank you, and I apologize if my answers are a little too long, but they're good questions. What is happening in the Republican Party especially is what we have seen ever since the beginning of the last century. The isolationists, the America firsters, the bring America home, come home America, all of that has been a fight within the Republican Party. Prior to World War II, was Henry Ford and Charles Lindbergh and many Western Republican senators versus the internationalists. And after World War II, was the Taft wing of our party versus the Eisenhower wing. After Vietnam, it was the same. So there's always been that element within the Republican Party. But it also means, and by the way, I grow a little tired of that, well, we are war-weary because of Iraq and Afghanistan. Yes, we're war-weary. My friend, we were war weary after losing 55,000 young Americans in Vietnam in a war that we lost. So all I can say is that it requires explaining to the American people what's at stake, both strategically and in our values. One thing I know about young Americans is they're idealists, as they should be. And I was just up at Kennedy at the school up there and had a long conversation with a lot of young people, some of the smartest in America are up there at the Kennedy School. And I have to say that it has a lot to do with leadership. I still believe that if the President of the United States sat in the Oval Office, as by the way, I personally told him he should do, and say, here's the pictures, my friends, of these 11,000 dead Syrians. Have you seen, has anybody seen those pictures on the internet? My God, dead children, dead people starved to death. I mean, and this is what Bashar Assad is doing. Every American, every young American should see those pictures and say, and we want to help these people, and we're not going to send American troops. It continues to, I don't get angry anymore. It saddens me when the President of the United States says that all we want to do is send troops. That is not true. You know, Henry Kissinger used to say when he was Secretary of State, the bureaucrats came with him with always three options. One, nuclear war. Two, do nothing. And three, what the bureaucratic option was, you know? And unfortunately, people like me are being painted as we want to send American troops, and that is not true. So I guess what I can say is we need to explain to these young people, as I try to do up at Harvard, and I talk to a lot of young people around the country, that this is offends everything we stand for and believe in. And it doesn't mean we're going to shed American blood, but it does mean that we can give them assistance so that they can fight for freedom.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you very much. It's good to see you again. I'm Ambassador of Azerbaijan. It's good to see you again. And thank you for your very strong remarks. I want to follow up on an earlier question. You spoke very forcefully about the situation in Ukraine. And I represent a country which first faced a violation of its territorial integrity when our land was occupied by Armenia. Today, we've seen the violation of territorial integrity of Georgia, Moldova, today of Ukraine. But under the circumstances, I want to ask the same question. What do you think the United States can and realistically can do at the moment? Because, you know, the perception has been that of very significant disengagement from the United States, from the area. So our people, everybody in the region is watching. And you could see the voting at the United Nations General Assembly when only several countries supported Ukraine's territorial integrity. That was Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Moldova. The rest either abstained or voted against, like Belarus and Armenia. So I think this is a very indicative situation. So what would you do, sir? Thank you.
First of all, I believe that there is nervousness throughout the region, including Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan, because of Vladimir Putin's ambitions for the restoration of the Russian Empire. Now, I'm not making that up. It was Vladimir Putin that said several times that the worst event of the 20th century was the breakup of the Soviet Union. He said it. I didn't say it. Obviously, I would never. But, but so we have to understand his ambitions. And by the way, on Ukraine, I believe it was Kissinger that said that Russia with Ukraine is an empire and Russia without Ukraine is a country. Now, I have said that Russia is a gas station masquerading as a country. And I take that back. I take it it's a mafia-run gas station masquerading as a country. But I think there's reasons for countries to be in the region to be very nervous. I was in Moldova recently and in the Baltics. You know, if there's ever a wonderful example of transition to democracy, it's the Baltics. Now, they had a lot of help from Scandinavian countries, but it's really remarkable what they've been able to achieve. But they're very nervous. Estonia has 30% of their population Russian-speaking. And one of the things that I've learned, and I should have probably known it before, all of the media, of Russian-speaking media, is dominated by Russia. There is no counter. So every one of these people who are Russian-speaking in these countries are exposed to Russian television, which is, one, entertaining, but two, all the news is obviously slanted in the pro-Russian, anti, whatever the government is that they're broadcasting into. I don't know what Vladimir Putin is going to do, and I'm not sure he knows what he's going to do. I predicted that he would go to Crimea as soon as Yanukovych fell, because he felt he could not give up Sevastopol. There's no way that you can have a vision of the restoration of the Russian Empire without your avenue to the Mediterranean. But I don't predict what he's going to do next. The separatist thing is already pretty successful for him without having to send the troops in. But he's not keeping 40,000 troops on the border just because of military exercises. That's why I think he's still examining his options. It shouldn't surprise us about Odessa. Odessa is a major port for him. So it shouldn't surprise us to see this turmoil and conflict in Odessa. Then the question is, what about Moldova and Transnistria? He's already got 1,400 Russian peacekeepers there. And again, I'm not sure what he's going to do. But look at what the price he has paid so far. De facto annexation of Crimea without any really reprisal. And by the way, Ukraine was guaranteed their territorial integrity plus Crimea in return for giving up the world's third largest nuclear inventory. When do you think the next time a country with nuclear weapons is going to give up their nuclear weapons? So all I can say is that I think that Vladimir Putin will go as far as he thinks that he can. And we all agree that the long-term prospects for Russia are terrible. We also agree that the long-term prospects for the United States economy are very good, for the reasons why I stated it in my statement. But in the short term, I really worry about the degree of adventurism in not only the Baltics, but also Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan to this customs union idea of his. And we need to reaffirm our alliance and our commitment to these countries. And by the way, one of the other things that I would do is advocate for a path to admission to NATO for both Georgia, especially Georgia, and Ukraine if they desire it.
I just want to add one thing there that comes from actually the Sedona Forum. The McCain Institute hosted a foreign policy forum in early April, and one of the speakers talked about Ukraine and mentioned that one of the things that Putin is very frightened of that we don't hear nearly enough about is that if the Ukrainian revolution is successful, that encourages the Moscow-based opposition, the Russian opposition, to think they actually can achieve their goal too. If it is possible to overthrow a corrupt government by taking to the streets, and if you can do it in Ukraine, which is the Russians regard as their a little brother, and that's probably putting it nicely, this could happen in Moscow too. And it's something that one of our fellows, Emily Parker, has written a book about in terms of the internet, the digital connections between the opposition in both these areas. So destabilizing Ukraine in itself accomplishes the goal of convincing his own people that it's not worth trying.
I think that's very important. A very important point. They certainly didn't want to see Yanukovych overthrown in a freely elected government there. Yeah.
There's one here. Mm-hmm.
Senator Sharon Burke with the New America Foundation. I have an observation and a question for you. My observation is just that you used to be a very forward-leaning and pragmatic voice on climate change, and I certainly hope that we'll hear you louder on that again. My question is, given the vision that you've laid out about the security challenges for the United States, what kind of military do you think we need, and is that the military that we have and that we're investing in? Where would you like to see changes? Or if it's perfect the way it is, that'd be very interesting, given your position on the Senate Armed Services Committee.
On the issue of climate change, I believe that climate change is taking place. I also am deeply disappointed in the backers of efforts to address the issue because they fail completely to support nuclear power. I know nuclear power works. I know it's clean. And I know it can be done. Instead, the Democrats shut down Yucca Mountain. There's really no movement towards it. You can build 1 million solar panels and it won't make up for one nuclear power plant, okay? And until my advocates to do something about climate change come on board on nuclear power, include me out, because it's not the complete answer. But I will be glad to work with them in any fashion. And the second question.
The military, state of the military.
I'm very disappointed in the military in this respect, that we still have terrible cost overruns in our acquisition process. It is offensive to all of us when an aircraft carrier has a $3 billion cost overrun. I wanted a new aircraft carrier. I thought we needed it, but I didn't think we needed it to go from $10 billion to $13 billion. There's a recent Air Force program that wasted $2.3 billion and we had nothing to show for it. It is disgraceful, and we still don't hold anybody accountable. And so I think we have to fix that. Second of all, sequestration is a meat axe, not a scalpel. There are many areas, particularly in these huge, gigantic, many thousand person staffs that these various commands have, and we can consolidate these commands. There's a lot of things we can do. But the problem is the sequestration affects the most difficult part of the military, and that's operations and training. And that's always the first to go. They cut out the operations and training, and that, of course, reduces our ability to really fight well and with efficiency. So I'd like to repeal sequestration, but I'd also like to see our acquisition process reformed to the point where we're not wasting these billions, not millions, not hundreds of millions, billions of dollars of taxpayers' money, and no one is ever had held accountable for it. And it's hard for me to go back to Arizona and say, I want a strong military and I want to spend more money on defense when we have these outrageous cost overruns. It makes it difficult for me.
So we have time for one last question. I'm just going to say.
Can we do two?
We'll do two. I'll just say, though, that Sharon Burke, who just asked that question, just joined New America this week. And before that, she was the Assistant Secretary at the Pentagon for Energy Operations. So we couldn't be happier to have her here asking those kinds of questions. I've got to go here over to the left. Suzanne.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. I'm Suzanne DiMaggio from New America Foundation. And Senator, thank you so much for being with us today. U.S. Undersecretary of State Wendy Sherman is currently in Vienna right now with her team negotiating the fourth round with the P5 plus one and the Iranians. So I have two questions. The first is if they reach a deal that addresses all the key U.S. concerns on level of enrichment, centrifuges, so forth, intrusive inspection regime, what are the chances of that happening? Do you feel optimistic at this moment? And secondly, of course, for the Iranians to agree this deal, they are looking for sanctions relief. As a leader in the Senate, if a deal comes through that is a win for the United States, will you use your leadership role to support the president in delivering on the sanctions relief necessary to make this deal a reality?
Your second question first. I'm working with Lindsey Graham and some others that any agreement would have to have congressional approval. Your first question, I see no way that we're going to have a good outcome. One reason is because right to enrich. There's no reason on God's green earth why Iran should maintain a right to enrich. We will provide them with all the nuclear material they need if they want to build nuclear power plants or use it for peaceful purposes. We already gave that up. The issue of the centrifuges. Right now, the 19,000 centrifuges are still spinning. Right now, there's been no change at Arak, the facility there. And very importantly, we have had no restrictions or curbs on the development. The way you make a nuclear weapon is three components. One is the material, the second is the warhead, and the third is the delivery system. Nothing is being done on the warhead or the delivery system. And we have information that they're developing much longer range missile capability. And they are continued developing nuclear warhead. None of those are in part of the investigation. This smacks of the North Korean deal under Bush. And I think we gave away on the right to enrich to start with was a cardinal error and serious mistake. As far as the sanctions are concerned, it was the foreign minister of a Middle Eastern country that told me that there's not an empty hotel room in Tehran. They're all doing deals now with the Iranians in anticipation of further relaxation or large gaping holes in the sanctions.
Thank you. Noel Perry, last question.
Noel Perry, founder of Next Capital.
Hang on 1 second, the mic's coming your way.
Noel Perry, founder of Next 10 in California. Senator, I wanted to ask a question about the South China Seas and what you would do there. And then also, if I could just go back to Syria and to Ukraine, if there's one thing that you would do if you were president, one action you would take today in both Syria and Ukraine, what would you do? Thank you.
That was three questions smuggled into one, but.
In Syria, as I mentioned, I'd establish the humanitarian zone, provide them with the weapons that they need to defend themselves. And I would put some pressure on, if I could, on Russia and Iran for what they're doing in the supplies there. As far as the South China Sea is concerned, my friends, we have to understand the Chinese. The Chinese are not interested in World War III, but the Chinese believe that the last 200 years were an aberration of history, and that it is the Chinese traditional role to be the dominant power in Asia. And they are now moving into Deng Xiaoping's fifth priority, which is buildup of their military. On the day that Chuck Hagel came over and announced our reductions in defense spending, the Chinese announced a 12.2% increase in their defense spending. What we need to do in Asia is spend a lot of time and effort, which this administration is to their credit, with alliances of various countries. The model for it is in Australia, and now we just concluded an agreement with the Philippines. And that is joint operating bases, not the traditional military base where you have the hospital and the school and all of that, but a joint operating basis where our forces come in, operate and train with the host country and other countries that come to train with you, and then we leave. And that, I think we could conclude that with a number of other countries, including Malaysia, including Indonesia, and by the way, including our friends, the Vietnamese, who are scared to death about China. By the way, there's a ship that's named after my father and grandfather, and it's in port in Yokosuka, Japan. And about a year ago, it paid a port visit to the port of Da Nang, which shows that if you live long enough, anything is possible in this world. So I think there has to be a united front of the United States and ASEAN countries in particular to make it clear that China faces a united Asian community, that there are certain things that they simply cannot and should not do. I worry a great deal, this latest confrontation with Vietnam in the last few days. My friends, I don't like to be too critical, but the Syria decision not to strike reverberated throughout the entire globe, not just in the Middle East, but throughout the entire globe, and it is having an effect. And the third part of your question?
Just one action in Ukraine.
One action. On Ukraine, I'd give them weapons with which to defend themselves. My friends, you can't make this story up. After a heated debate in the White House, they decided that they would send MREs. I think we now should call it MRE diplomacy. They decided they would send MREs to Ukraine. But then someone said, well, we don't want to fly them in a US aircraft because that might provoke Vladimir Putin. So we leased German trucks to take the MREs in. My friends, these people don't have body armor. They don't have night vision capability. They don't have defensive weapons. And would be providing them defensive weapons allow them to defeat Russia and Putin's troops? Of course not. nor probably did the British and the French, the French and others, help us during our revolution think it would help us defeat the British. But the point is, it would have helped their morale enormously, and believe me, at some point, Ukraine will fight. The people of Ukraine have a long history of fighting for their independence, and they're not going to sit idly by and watch Vladimir Putin absorb part of their country into Russia. So it's just shameful that we wouldn't give them weapons with which to defend themselves. And the other, of course, as I mentioned, if they want to be part of NATO, there's a long process, by the way. You don't just accept membership, and we could put them on a military assistance plan. And by the way, we have military assistance programs with at least 50 countries. It would not be an earth-shaking or new kind of thing to give these people some ability to defend themselves. I was in Maidan. I was there. And I saw 200,000 young people, mostly young people, in sub-freezing weather demonstrating because they didn't want to be part of Russia. Their European culture, music, food, everything, and most essentially freedom and lack of corruption. They want to be like part of Europe, not part of Russia. And that is true even in Eastern Ukraine amongst young people. And it seems to me that we ought to be assisting them rather than sitting by and watching them be dismembered. Could I mention one other issue with you really quick that's going on? It just came from a hearing. And that's this veterans issue that you know is so terrible. There are allegations, and they haven't been proven, but there certainly is great amount of substance to them that we're not giving the care to our veterans. You know, in Phoenix Veterans Hospital, there's an allegation that 40 people died while waiting to receive care. It's really terrible. Short term, we got to fix it. Long term, we should give our veterans the flexibility to go anywhere to get the health care they need. In other words, why should a veteran have to ride in a van 3 hours from Sholo, Arizona down to Phoenix to the VA hospital to get care when he could get it from a caregiver right there in his hometown? We need to embark on a path to give our veterans the ability and flexibility to get the care that they want. Now, PTSD, war wounds, prostheses, there's nobody that does that like the VA. But and we need to preserve that. But overall, this is really a national tragedy, particularly as we approach Memorial Day, that it appears there's very, very strong evidence that we have not provided our veterans with the care that they have earned. And the next time you're going through National Airport or any place else and you see one of these young people in uniform, just go over and say thanks for serving.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Senator McCain, thank you.